And so, we don't need a motherfucker that got mixed loyalties. He got to check with his heir constituent. He got to check. Obama got to check with his Jew constituent before he can make a motherfucking decision on what move to make in Africa. Because they can't, you understand, they can't put their constituents in a bad position, okay? So we don't need nobody that got mixed loyalties. We need a motherfucker that is gonna look out for African people first and foremost all the time, 100% for African people. And so when Marcus Garvey came with the powerful slogan, Africa for Africans, that right there sent a shiver across the African continent, because they seen a formidable foe in Marcus Garvey like they hadn't seen in no other African in the history of the Western Hemisphere. Marcus Garvey had a lot of momentum. Get in the ships, get in the trained minds, the scientists, the engineers, and the teachers. And so, just like the cracker got his CIA, the Arab got they undercover agents that move in to communities, to upset communities for their best benefit. And so, when Marcus Garvey came with this great nationalist idea, it was a truly a African, pan-African nationalism. Then they move in, sabotage our great Messiah, our great prophet, our great leader, the father of this black nationalist, pan-African nationalist movement. They moved in on him. We didn't protect him. And so, you understand what I'm saying? They seized a great opportunity from our people to really make a difference. We always run from confrontation. And understanding that at some point in time, you got to stand your ground. And no matter what the advantages and disadvantages may be, we got to understand without a stand right now here today that African peoples is clearly at the point of no return. We have to make a stand at some point in time. And so what I'm looking at today with the British, with the United States, and these European powers attacking Libya, it is no different when Rome attacked Carthage. You understand what I'm saying? The only thing is, at that time, it was African people in control of their land. But the geography remains the same, and it is a fight for the Mediterranean and the Suez Canal. Okay? It's a fight to regain sovereignty over the Mediterranean and the Suez Canal. You understand? And to put that boot back down on the necks of the Arab and African to let them know that the white man is still fully in control. So he thinks. That's his agenda. I'm not saying that he will be successful in it, but that's his agenda. When we look at North Africa, we can see with the rock paintings at Tassili, Angier, that all of North Africa was once populated by an all-African population. And let me be clear about it. There is no such thing as a white African. There's no such thing as an Arab African. There's no such thing as an Indian African. There's no such thing as a Chinese African. the only kind of African that it is a black African. And I don't say it together, black, as Dr. Clark said, we don't say black African, because that presupposes that there is a legitimate white Africa. There is no legitimate white Africa. There is no legitimate Arab Africa. But what I'm saying is the only type of African that there is a black African. Even when you look at the coin that they found of Hannibal, the elephant on one side and Hannibal on the other, it was clear that he had thick African locks on his head. And his phenotype was purebred African. So we are 100% sure that all of North Africa was controlled by the indigenous black African population. And so when you look at Gaddafi, he is only the son of our white mothers. You know, they got a little curl in their goddamn hair, but their fathers was Arab, okay? And so their cultural background is Arab, okay? He's a Islamic imperialist colonialist. And whether he, you know, he put a few Africans in positions of power, that's no different than the crackers over here putting a few niggas in power. That's only tokenism, okay? And so what we have to do is to go back in our history, understand how we got into this position, understand who our enemies is, understand what we must do to neutralize our enemies. All African states in Africa that are ran by indigenous Africans should come into a African Union to at least bring power to those African nations that still have our indigenous culture. And then you got some African nations, they more Muslim than the goddamn Arab. You got some of them niggas over there more Christian than the fucking cracker in Rome. And so we fighting from all directions. We fighting a political fight. We fighting a religious fight, because now we have retained the religion of our oppressors, and we fight over shit that even the oppressor don't even fight for. Because he knew he constructed it only for political control and mental control over the people. He didn't actually think motherfuckers gonna be fighting over some fake-ass tombs, and she ain't there for that shit. Talking about some tomb, some Dome of the Rock. They don't give a fuck about that. It's the land. It's the fact that those areas are strategically placed, and anyone who controls those strategic areas has an economic or political advantage over the rest of the world. Okay? And so we have to come back to Marcus Garvey. We have to come back to Kwame Nkrumah. We got to come back to Patrice Lumumba. And we have to, again, think seriously about the Pan-Africanism, the global African supremacy. See, the Pan-African nationalism, the one thing that it lacks for me is the necessary military component that it's gonna take. We ain't just can't just go to Africa and expect. Just like this cracker, nigga, Obama, goes and bomb. When they feel that, you understand, you have gained control over the land from a political standpoint, a cultural standpoint, he will move in military to seize it back. So you just can't go there thinking that we're going to set up some type of government, and that the oppressor, for the same reason he came in the first time, he'll come in again. So we must neutralize our oppressor and our enemy. And both Gaddafi and Obama is the enemy to African people. They are both in the hands and pockets of the slave master, whether it be the Jew, whether it be the Anglo-Saxon cracker, whether it be the Arab. None of them have African people's best benefit on their agenda. If they did, they wouldn't even be on our land as imperialists and colonialists. So we must look at this attack on Libya, which is really have nothing to do with us, particularly it does. It is a war between the Jew and the Arab. It's a war between the Arab and the Anglo-Saxon cracker, okay? And it is a fight for the dominance and superiority in the Mediterranean, the Suez Canal, and the mineral wealth of Africa. And we have to come to understand that no way possible that Africa is going to be healthy until the indigenous people of that continent take back control and do what's best for African people, put in a government that understands what Africa is, the cultural root of Africa, the love of Africa, and bring African people back into a healthy state of living. This is your brother Sarah Sutton said he said, hey, arm yourself with knowledge, bang on that wicked ass beast daily, liberation through education and confrontation. African power.